Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this session on winning the game of HR with mindfulness through Digital HR and Monk at Work Associations. So many of you know about Digital HR, which is a leading community of HR professionals aiming digital transformations and innovations in HR practices developed by InnoServe Group. And as you all know that we have organized many webinars and masterclasses recently in last 6 months, we have developed this community to around 25,000 plus HR professional across the nations and developed, more than 10 city chapters for the HRs on over the WhatsApp. And we have conducted many webinars on industries like, e-commerce, fintech, healthcare industries, and various masterclasses like, mindfulness, employer brandings, power of finance for HRs basically. So these are the knowledge sharing sessions that we are doing and we have done and will keep doing this under the digital HR platform that has been, developed with you guys, all supports that, has been developed here. So if we talk about today, as we all know about the world of HR is rapidly changing, and today's session is aimed at diving deep into a few fascinating and futuristic trends, basically. So, rather than wasting much of time, I would like to, invite Mr. Sapan Simal, director of Monk at Work with us today, who is, a thought leader on mindfulness at workplace and is known as his insightful perspective on leadership and culture. He has supported and consulted leading organizations across the industries, including many Fortune 500 companies. He has been a speaker at various industry forums, and his perspective have been captured in publications of prominence. I request him to take this sessions forward rather than wasting much of my time. Let me hand it over to Mr. Sapan Simal so he can give the he can start the sessions on today's mindfulness part. Mr. Sapan, over to you. You can take it ahead.
Thank you so much, Ritesh, for setting the context so well and for the kind intro that you shared. So good evening, friends. Hope you are all doing well on this Saturday evening. I hope I'm audible to everyone. This is the first formal check that we need to do. And if you can confirm, okay, thank you. Thanks, Dr. Jeevan. That helps. Thanks, Pina. And this chat window is going to be our window of communication because I can't see you. Rather, let's see if you can switch on your videos, if possible. I will be able to see the faces and talk to them rather than talking to the presentation slide or the just the single screen. So if possible, do that.
Sorry, but I think in this webinar, you won't be, see their
for
video.
Sure.
Simply,
sure.
You can be on the
sure. setting. Okay. It's not
a webinar features, yeah.
Yeah. No problem. So I think let's be connected on this chat window. So this chat window is our window of communication, window of connection today. In these days of complete isolation, partial isolation, this is such a great time to be together with so many like-minded people. I'm feeling so privileged, so great that we are all together. Thanks, especially on this account. Now, even before we go into the session, let's do something which our lives very rarely allow us to do. And that's taking a pause. I request each one of you to take a few seconds and become aware of your surroundings. Just notice the colors around. Vivid variety of colors. Notice different shapes. 2D and 3D shapes all around us. At this point, also become aware of your posture. And now become aware of your state of mind right now. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you. This was to bring all our scattered minds into this present setting. So we are here for the winning the game of HR with mindfulness. And today, the whole session is about rediscovering some of the strategic focus areas of HR. We'll be talking some things, a big larger picture. We are going to talk about the larger trends, futuristic trends, which are going to shape HR and its employee interface. Something, you know, some of the aspects that we discuss might even seem unconventional to you, but believe me, all those trends are going to be mainstream in possibly next 5 years. So the agenda for our session is that we will first discuss what's the HR strategy now and how possibly some of the things are not working and where the shift is happening gradually, where we are moving towards, how is mindfulness relevant, if at all, and let's see if mindfulness can play any role and how we as HR fraternity can leverage this. Can leverage this for our people, for our employees, leverage this for our organizations, and leverage this for ourselves as HR professionals. Yeah. So very quickly, let's get into the game of HR, winning the game of HR. What do you think is one strategic focus in HR? What is one area, one aspect that should be the core focus of a HR leader, HR professional? I know it's a little wide question, but still, what you feel. And this area is something which is core, which possibly impacts multiple facets and which is there not only for a short period, it's like forever. I mean, for example, digital focus, it could be there for some time, but it may change, but there's something which will remain always forever. So I think what as example, Kavita is mentioning employee satisfaction. Very nice, very nice. Employee satisfaction, the second answer, again, employee satisfaction. So nice. Wow, employee productivity, excellent. Engagement and development, very nice, thank you. Engagement, we are seeing three themes, engagement, satisfaction, productivity, and definitely focus on business, very nice. Excellent, excellent. Continuous improvement, and continuous improvement again is a great term, but possibly where all do we do continuous improvement is important. So we need to understand the focus where we will do the continuous improvement. Transformation of people, mental health, excellent, excellent. We are talking about well-being, work culture, excellent, excellent. Strategy alignment, business strategies with human interventions. Very nice. How do we connect business and human side? And this is something which we are going to definitely talk in detail. Talent development, work-life balance. Excellent. Excellent. Alertness, possibly, and empathy towards staff. Very nice. Very nice. Excellent. Great suggestions that you have come out with. And let me share and possibly, the crux or possibly anything that you are mentioning about, whether it is work-life balance, employee motivation, everything somewhere are going towards what you mentioned initially in terms of employee satisfaction, engagement. Let me say employee engagement could be one. I'm not saying that this is the only one central focus area, but this is possibly one of the core areas because it impacts so many things. And there has been a lot of research which has gone into it, employee engagement, Gallup surveys, so much happens. And there has been a clear realization, highly engaged employees are doubly effective. That has been proven. Revenue is very high, profitability is very high. Retention, it's common sense that it is high. Engagement is the core central area. Rather, let me just show you this Gallup's finding how much, I don't want to, bombard you with data at the beginning itself, but this very interesting slide to see how engagement as a factor can create so much magic. We are talking about business, right? Business focus, alignment of business and HR. Here, there is something which can do so much magic. So definitely engagement definitely remains as the core focus area because it is about the will of employees to contribute. The second area I think somebody mentioned here was about development, was about productivity, was about capabilities. And here we are talking about how we help our employees to become more capable. So while they have a will to contribute, do they have ability to contribute? And that's where the skills, the training, the development of capabilities, all those things come into picture, because willingness may not always translate into the capability. And the third aspect, again, as you mentioned, all from work-life balance to mental health to so many things, is the well-being area. And as we see, while the person is willing, while the person is able to contribute, the person might not sustain the contribution if he or she is not taking care of well-being. So well-being is a definitely important part, not only from productivity. Well-being is also a very important part to care for as human beings. So today, for our discussion, as we are getting into strategic focus areas, we are going to look at these three areas from the trend perspective. And I'm not saying that these are the only three areas. There are many other important areas, but for our discussion today, these itself are very large impact areas. And let's see how we are working, how we are, how is our progress on each of these areas? And do we need some sort of strategic shift here? And let's spend some time. We are going to spend some time in deep diving into each of these three areas. Okay. Now, engagement. And here, let me ask this question to you again. How do organizations enhance engagement? Any quick suggestions that you might have, or any quick thoughts that you have seen world's topmost organizations doing this? Oh, absolutely. There's a needs to be a job clarity. There has to be an absolute right understanding, open communication, open house, nice. Planning. Basically, we are talking about getting the employees more and more connected with us. Yeah, employee welfare, providing growth, learning path. And you would definitely agree that we are spending a lot of time and efforts and money on this. There is a huge effort happening on employee engagement. Employee engagement is right now the holy grail of, you know, everything that we are talking about in HR. Engagement is like everything. And as you are mentioning here, from employee welfare to growth to learning path to recognition programs, you are mentioning there is so much happening and there is so much work happening around getting people to be engaged. Now, let me just ask you and give a very honest answer. We are going to be very honest to each other today. How much successful are we in our engagement efforts? You can give a subjective answer or you can give a percentage answer, like what Suprabha has mentioned, possibly 30, 40, 50%. We are, yeah, okay, to some extent. Again, great. I think we have answers coming from less than 10% to 50, 60%. Okay, obviously it's subjective. It's very much dependent on the organization, but definitely it's a important thought to ponder, because if we consider engagement as the holy grail, and it's not just today, for last possibly 1.5, 2 decades, it has been of very, very high importance. A lot of research, a lot of action is happening, a lot of money is going into it. How much is our success area? And let me just share with you, and as you mentioned, I saw, you know, from 10%, less than 10% to 50, 60% is the answer. I'm not giving you any answer on this percentage, but some indicators. You would know this very famous study from Gallup, and Gallup keeps doing these engagement surveys every year, and 85% employees are not engaged. Only 15% employees are actually engaged. 85%. Now, despite our so much efforts, 85% not engaged, and almost 30-35% are actively disengaged. Okay, they are dangerous to the organizations. Now, our engagement program are working or not, we don't know. Another indicator is last 12 years, engagement levels have not changed much. There has been a bit of percentage points here and there. Last 12 years, what's happening? The holy grail of engagement, we are doing so much. There is so much investment, there is so much time. And as the whole community today is sitting here, is talking about engagement as a primary area. So we know how much conscious efforts we are putting into it, but success is still so limited. This is not good. And another survey mentions that because when the employees are disengaged, globally organizations are losing $600 billion. I think we know a bit about this number, and that's the reason we are spending so much on the engagement. But there is something missing here. Is our focus on, so for example, we spoke about open houses, we spoke about so many employee programs and all those things. Now, what's happening? Why these programs are not working? Is this something bigger aspect that we are missing? And let's explore. We may not have 100% answers, but I think it's an important point to explore from the angle that we are HR professionals who are going to make a difference to this industry. We are going to make a difference to people. So what we are doing, our efforts should pay, you know, give the outcomes. So let me share with you a very interesting statistic. Again, believe me, I don't think I'm going to share anything which you don't know. But possibly today we are going to connect a few independent aspects and come out with some of the trends which would be very helpful for us for the future. So this statistic is again something is not something new to you. I think you all know about it. The manager is responsible for 70% variance in engagement. And now if you would just go back and look on the comments that we all have posted, how much is the percentage focus on the manager? Manager is creating the difference. And we are going to go a little bit more deep. We are on the engagement part and what's creating the difference. We are realizing manager is the one who creates the difference, and there is no doubt. There is a very, very common saying that people join organizations and leave bosses. Okay. It's also true that people join organizations and they stay with their bosses. Okay. We all have seen people moving along with their bosses. Or we have also seen that people are leaving organizations because of bosses. Okay. There was a study conducted which said almost 50% employees, 48% I think to be accurate, have left a job because the boss was so intimidating and it was impacting them. They just wanted to get away from their boss, and that's the reason they left the organization. Very sad affair. So what we are saying possibly is, we are not saying manager makes all the difference. I'm sure, you know, the overall company culture, overall, there are a lot of things which happens, but organization speaks through manager. For me, the organization is largely the manager. Okay. So manager, whatever is happening between manager and me, creates the whole variance. And in this also, so we spoke about engagement is the biggest factor. In engagement, manager is the biggest factor. Now in manager, what is the factor? What is it that manager is doing or not doing, which makes the difference? Yeah. Let's consider these statements. Okay. I would request you to go through these three statements as they are coming in front of you. And now, each one of you, just in your own mind, give scoring. Okay, 10 is the highest and 1 is the least score. Give the scoring to your current manager or possibly some of your earlier managers. In your own mind. We don't want it coming here. But just give it now. Again, in your own mind, just make a larger picture. In my organization, if I ask people generally how much score they will give to their manager, what would be the average? I'm sure you have got the pulse of your organization or the geography or the function that you are responsible for. If you just give a little thought, closing your eyes and say, how much will the managers get the score? Believe me, the score that you will get is going to correlate with the engagement score. Here and there, little bit, a few percentage points here or there. Okay. Yeah, some of you have mentioned the pointers as well. So we know the situation is not that great. Very rarely do people go beyond 5. It's mostly 5 and lesser. This is what, when we have asked the organizations, this is what we have also got, which is not a good part. But look at these questions and we will realize something important. Engagement is important. In engagement, manager is important. And in manager, what is important? When I feel, and you know, we are not talking about manager showing care. We are talking about manager caring. Whether it is coming in words or not, it's a different thing. We all understand. If your manager cares for you, you know. I mean, the person does not have to pretend or, you know, demonstrate it a lot. Demonstration rather goes on the other side. There is a lot of care which is coming in, which is making the whole difference. Now, this care is such feel like that goody-goody, you know, goody-feely feeling. Do people make decisions based on this goody-goody feeling? Oh, yes. Okay. Empathy or care, which I receive from my manager, is one of the biggest things. Just think about you. Who are the managers whom you respect the most? And you would realize that they care for your best interest. Okay. Who is the manager you hate the most? Is the person who has never cared about you, who has just been selfish and possibly narcissist. Yeah. Okay. And let me share with you a few findings. We are going to go a lot into some of the research findings which have happened, you know, which will show where, you know, what we are talking about is not just, on the gut basis, on the gut feel basis. Okay. Now, we all are talking about attrition and retentions. Look at it. Simple empathy can make 92% employees more likely to stay in the organization. Retention. Okay. Retention we are talking about. We do so much about retention. A simple empathy. And empathy is, again, I think let's understand empathy. Empathy is not you know, somebody is just, you know, showing some nicey, goody feeling behavior. Empathy is a very hardcore feeling where I, as an individual, care for you that, okay, I feel that, you know, what is in your best interest? Can I do something about it? Do I take extra efforts? That's the empathy. That's the care we are talking about. We are not talking about some very emotional, feely empathy. 77% employees. Okay, if your organization is not empathetic, believe me, whatever salary the other person is offering, other organization is offering, they will go away. 3/4 of the people will go away if other organization is more empathetic. Okay, and this is very interesting. Okay, they can work for a pay cut as well if they receive more empathy. What else do we say? I mean, you know, we are talking about financial motivations. We are talking about so many other motivations, but a simple caring attitude. If a manager shows caring attitude, yes, I am working towards your best interest. Okay. This can make so much difference. So much difference. Okay. Empathy. I request possibly after the session, you may go and do your own research on empathy and care. Okay. What it leads us to this understanding. Okay. Employee engagement. What is employee engagement? We all understand that, you know, I care for the organization. I take extra steps. I make sure that everything is happening right. It's a very, very heart-to-heart connect. The employee feels a very strong connect, emotional heart-to-heart connect for the organization. But if my boss, and my boss would mean organization for me, is not empathetically connected with me, do you think that relationship will go ever? I mean, relationships are not based on one-way traffic. So we as organizations, we as managers cannot be transactional and then expect employees to be engaged. Now, this is very unfair deal. I am just being transactional with the person. I give you salary, just get the work done. And I expect the employee to be, you know, I mean, go extra mile and think and care about the organization. How can we expect that to happen? Care from employee cannot come unless care from organization, care from manager, largely manager is going. We keep talking about employee engagement, but believe me, employee engagement is not something which we can achieve by doing a few things. Employee engagement is a reciprocal behavior which we receive when we have a reverse engagement, as we call it, which means the manager is engaged with the employee. Manager is invested in the employee. Now, what it means is, if we ever want to win the game of engagement, we cannot do it. I mean, you know, all the things that we do, employee programs, open house, there are so many things that we do and they are well intended and they are very, very important. I'm not saying anything is substitute, but the point is we will not achieve our goal unless we have this main ingredient, which is reverse engagement, where as manager, every manager start actually acting in a way that I genuinely care for the employee. And there is going to be a big, big strategic shift, big, big mindset shift. So the first strategic shift that we are talking about is in terms of engagement. One big shift that you are going to see in the coming years is more and more organizations will now move away from trying to push employees to feel engaged. Rather, they are going to make focus on the managers and see how they can become more empathetic. And accordingly, as a consequence, the employees will be more engaged. It's like, you know, I mean, I'm giving a little different example. It's like, rather than focusing on customers, there are many organizations who have started focusing on the employees. So they say employee first. Why employee first? I take care of employee. Employee will take care of the customer. Now that's a great sequence. That's a great, you know, logical step. In the same way, rather than focusing on employee engagement, I focus on manager to become empathetic, genuinely empathetic towards the employees. Okay. So this is the first strategic shift. Empathy, how do we achieve that? What can be done about it? Is something possibly we'll discuss a little later, but let's take a pause here on the engagement part and let's shift to the second part. Capability. And again, let me ask you the same thing. What are the strategies that we follow to build skills, knowledge, attitude? That's the capability that we are talking about. We are not talking about new capability in terms of new talent acquisition. We are talking about existing talent and how do we enhance that talent? How do we gain? And the whole idea is productivity. How do I, as an organization, gain the best productivity in my organization? What all do I do? Again, let's have some thoughts. And these thoughts are important. Okay, upskill. Okay, little more specific, if we can give little more details around that. So what exactly do we do to make sure that our employees are more productive? Identifying the high potential, good. Reskilling, correct, perfect. Talent management initiative, recognition, training employees. Great. Employee progression plan, great, wonderful ideas. Okay. So identifying the strengths, to identifying the high potential, to making them available the right skilling, reskilling, upskilling options, competency development, development plans, absolutely great. Perfect. So largely what we do is we identify people, we identify the skills, we find out the best, knowledge programs, training programs, we help them to understand those programs, and then we expect them to implement those programs and those learnings that they have got. Okay. Now, again, I'll ask you the same question. And I'm going to ask you the same question again when we'll talk about well-being as well. But these are the hard look that we need to take on ourselves as HR fraternity. And we say, you know, what's happening? Is are we doing good? Are we doing right or not? How much do you think are our efforts successful? Again, a guesswork. I mean, we are just talking about a very ballpark figure. So no big, don't try to be too accurate on this. Oh, almost 80%. Great. 80%, 30, 40%, 70%. Excellent. Very nice. And I think it's very visible that compared to engagement, we are doing better on this. Okay, definitely. I think this is definitely a better area. But still, I should show you some of the eye-opening numbers. I mean, I think that's my job. Yeah. So let's look at these. Even some of the people are saying 10 to 15%. Our success is possibly 10 to 15%. So we are seeing 10 to 15% to 80% is the range that I'm getting. Okay, great. And again, surely depending on organization, depending on people, it would be different. But again, let's look at the larger global trend. Almost $366 billion are spent on leadership and related programs. And research shows that only 10% programs actually deliver the outcomes. 10%. Okay. And you know the reason why the CEO and CFOs keep asking, okay, what's the ROI on this program? And we as HR professionals, you know, really need to, because it is so intangible that we just can't tell the ROI and those things. So it is very difficult. But the point is there are many other factors despite our best efforts, the leadership programs or even training programs many times, and especially the behavioral skills. Yeah. Technical skills many times are very much very tangible. So, you know, there is an input and there is an output. Still, when you are talking about the larger success, 60, 70, 80%, you would realize that it is happening in technical areas. But if it comes to behavioral areas, I think you would also realize that it is as challenging as engagement is. We are still not able to crack the code. Emotional intelligence. I mean, emotional intelligence for the last 40 years is around, and you know, we are doing so much around emotional intelligence. Have our employees become emotionally intelligent? Have our leaders become emotionally intelligent? I think, you know, again, you would want to give this answer inside your mind. So there are so many programs which are not working. Okay. Behavioral outcomes. Again, I think as Sonal is mentioning that it is not more than 15%. You are so true. Absolutely. Now, let's do something different now. To understand the aspect of productivity and, you know, the whole performance part that HR as a fraternity HR we want to drive. So we will do a little quick exercise, very interesting, very different exercise as comparatively we have been doing. I would request you for a 2-minute exercise, and we will do it with closed eyes. And tell me if you're all ready, if you can write a yes in the chat window. That would help me to know that we are all connected. Oh, great. Thank you. Believe me, your responses, your yes, your no are so important, because that's how I feel connected with you. So thank you so much. Thanks, every one of you. Thank you. So this is a very interesting exercise. We are going to understand our mind. Okay. We are going to monitor our mind in these 2 minutes. And I will set a timer for 2 minutes. And I'll ask you to close your eyes. And what you need to do is just close your eyes and observe what your mind is doing. What's happening inside your mind. That's it. Very simple. Just what's happening inside the mind. Okay. Don't shut it down. Don't try to focus on your breathing or colors or images or anything. Don't do anything. Just be an observer. What's happening. Yeah. So please close your eyes. And your time starts now. Okay, so 2 minutes are over. You can open your eyes. And as you open your eyes, and as you come back into the session, just reflect what happened. What was your mind doing? What was happening inside your mind? And if you can just write it in the chat window, that would be very helpful. Very quick, one word, one phrase. Thanks, Rakesh. Office. The whole mind is wandering. Srinivas is mentioning. Yeah. So look at our mind. Okay. I mean, it's even thinking, okay, what's going to happen next? Lots of thoughts, problems to tackle. You know, even wondering why are we doing this exercise? There's so much of restlessness. There are a couple of people who are saying that I was calm also, but look at so many people, believe me, you know, and it was not even 2 minutes. I stopped the timer in 90 seconds. Okay. In 90 seconds, our mind was doing the complete world tour. Okay. Now we are talking about capability constraints, productivity constraints. And we are taking a very different view right now from the skills and other things. We are taking a very different thought process. So stay with me for 3-4 minutes on this, and then we'll realize the context. Okay, great. Sankalp is saying, what am I not able to do? There are so many thoughts coming. Even many of you got thoughts which you thought, how this thought can come to me now in these 90 seconds? Not possible. Some of you even opened your eyes, yeah, and you wanted to check if I'm disconnected or what, isn't it? So this is called mind wandering. I think most of us are familiar with this term, but what we are not familiar with is what it does. Now, mind wandering is when I am here, physically here, and my mind has gone somewhere else without me being aware of it. I get the awareness later on, but you know, it has just gone there. Now, interestingly, when my mind is wandering, I can be physically active, this is important. I am physically active, but intellectually I am zero. I cannot do critical thinking. I cannot do decision making. I cannot do problem solving. I cannot think creatively. Intellectually, I am zero. Now, how much percentage of our time do you think we wander? Our mind wanders. I mean, you have just experienced mind wandering. So any quick percentage thought, how much percentage of our time the mind would be wandering? Very quickly, very approximate, 60-70%, 80%. Okay. This is the absolute normal range that we always get, 60-70% to 90 to like almost all the time. Okay. Now Daniel Gilbert and Matthew Killingsworth, two very renowned scientists, did a very extensive study on this. Okay. Somebody is saying 98% in this pandemic. They realized, Matthew Killingsworth and Daniel Gilbert, they did a study in 2010, and they found that our mind wanders 47% of the time, and 47% is huge because half of our intellectual capacity is just going down the drain. But you would realize that this study was done in 2010. We are in 2020. Things have changed so much. And as I think Selja is saying, that in this pandemic, it would be 98%. So this 47% would be 74, 84, 94, or 98. I think you are more accurate than this study is. True. But this is very sad. This is very sad. Imagine 70, 80, 90% of our intellectual capacity just going down the drain. And not only that, when this study was published, it was published under the heading, "A Wandering Mind is an Unhappy Mind." So what is the bonus? Not only you lose the productivity, it also creates a deep state of unhappiness inside us. What a bad deal. So mind wandering is really, really bad. But again, coming to the productivity side, okay, we are talking about the capability. Now imagine our employees whose mind is wandering 50, 60, 70, 80, 90% of the time. How do we get, and they are giving some intellectual output. How do we get high quality output from them? Let me also share another constraint with you. Okay. distracted thinking, and distraction is something which we consider as very trivial and very normal that happens. But let's think about it. Let's go, you know, spend 2-3 minutes in this on this topic. Imagine you are thinking about some important problem, or you are thinking of a creative idea, or you are trying to make a presentation, or you know, or you are writing something. Now, as you begin to do that, you realize initial 10, 15, 20, 30 minutes, the mind is not so stable. Mind needs, you know, gradually there are so many random thoughts, but gradually the rhythm sets in. You would have been, you know, sitting on an important work on a weekend or in the morning or evening, and you would have realized that initial part is very, very fluttery. And after that, the rhythm sets in. But the question is, why don't I become optimum in the beginning itself? Why does it take time? This is a question we should ask. Yeah. And this happens with us all the time. I mean, remember our school days as well, when we used to study the first 10, 15 minutes, the focus will not be there, but afterwards it will come. When you're sitting in the examination, first 10, 15 minutes, focus will not come. Afterwards, we are so focused that we don't even remember anything outside the examination hall. Why does that happen? And the reason is our mind is constantly in commotion and agitation all the time. But when we start focusing on one task, the agitation and commotion gets to stabilize, the settle down. And then we become more focused, and then we become more deep. And if we continue in the same activity, same task without distraction, we become more deep, more focused, more stable, more deep, more focused, more stable. And then we gradually reach to those deeper zones of our mind where the real creativity, where the real ideation, solutionizing, high productivity, high focus, this is all is seated there in those zones. But we are not reaching to those zones, those different levels. And it's not that one particular zone level, it's a gradual zone that we are going in. Okay, but we are not able to go there. Okay, now let me ask you this question. How frequently do we get distracted? Because we are talking about undistracted time for a longer duration. How frequently? Every how many minutes, seconds, hours that you get distracted on an average by external disturbances and by internal thoughts, both. Any quick reflection? Every 10 minutes, every 2-3 minutes? Oh, absolutely. Perfect. 20-30 minutes. Great. I think this group is great because I have hardly seen people talking in terms of 10, 20, 30 minutes. So great that you are able to achieve that type of levels. Okay. Now let me share with you. Okay. Sudha is saying 30 seconds. So, you know, Sudha, you are actually close to one study which says we get distracted every 40 seconds when we are sitting in front of the screen. Okay. Now you might have seen these books. And these are valuable books for us as professionals, for us even important as HR professionals. Carl Newport says in Deep Work that we can achieve exponential productivity and exponential creativity if we begin to follow the principles of undistracted working. And flow, as Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi mentions in this book, he's a great psychologist. He says we can achieve magic. Because he talks about the experiences of musicians, adventurers, sports people, and so many other people who get so much deep into those zones where magic happens. There are some things which are normally not achievable and people are able to achieve that. And it comes with a lot of joy. Okay. But we are not able to achieve those zones. We are working and distraction. Believe me, the way we work, possibly we are not even using 1% of our real deep capacity. And this capacity is not something, you know, Einstein mind we have to acquire, or it's not. It's the capacity which is available to us right now. We are just not able to access that. Now think from your employees' angles. Okay. Look at them, how distracted, how wandering they are. Okay. You would want to refer to them this book, Nicholas Carr. He says, we are becoming experts at scanning and skimming things, bite-sized details, and just move on. Bite-sized details, just move on. Even a one-minute video, we can't see without scrolling. Okay. We just don't have not got, you know, we are losing the capacity to sustain our attention longer on a particular thing because, and this is a great danger because as Nicholas Carr says, we are losing the core human capabilities, competencies of deep thinking, insights, contemplation, reflection. These are only human beings can do. And we are losing these capabilities, which is very sad. Now, when we are talking in terms of employee capability, employee productivity, definitely we must talk in terms of the skills and training and technical skills and behaviors. They are non-negotiable. We got to have that. But we got to reflect what and where the real productivity gain will come from. If we are getting distracted and using 1% capacity, can I use some undistracted principles? Even if I go to 2%, I'm doubling my efficiency. My mind wandering, if it is right now 90%, I'm using 10% of my intellectual capacity. If my I reduce my mind wandering to 70%, I'm tripling my intellectual capacity. Now, we are not talking about some percentage point increase. We are talking about exponential increase by doing this. Now, this is the shift. This is the shift that we are talking about in the new knowledge economy. You might have come across this book called Focus Economy, Attention Economy. Okay. Attention Economy is the book which talks about how much important the attention of our employees is. We are losing so much as people's attention is wandering and going here and there. So here is the thing. You would see so much happening during last one decade, especially there is so much work has happened on attention and focus. Daniel Goleman, we all know from his work on emotional intelligence, he wrote a book called Focus. Okay. And he mentions the strategies to bring focus. And these strategies are not only external strategies. These are very, very neurological and, you know, internal strategies that he brings in. And he explains why focus is extremely, extremely critical to all aspects of our life. From health to relationships, to productivity, to success, to anything, to leadership. Yeah. So there is a big strategic shift which is happening right now. You remember, I mean, you would know, and we keep talking about it earlier, the whole focus was technical skills. And then gradually people started talking about, no, behavioral skills are also important. There was a shift. And shift does not mean substitution. Technical skills are absolutely important. Okay. But what we are saying is we were ignoring behavioral skills. Let's not ignore behavioral skills. They are actually very, very important. Now today we are witnessing another shift. And in the next 5 to 6 years, we are going to witness it even more rapidly is not only behavioral skills, but we need to train our people in attention skills. This is one thing which we are missing badly. Now, let me give you an example. I mean, we keep helping people with so many training programs, so many behavioral skills and all. The point is, if their mind is wandering, if their attention is not there, one, their grasping is extremely low. Second, when the application time comes, that application is also low. So it's like, you know, I mean, just using this term, but, you know, take it symbolically that we are possibly filling an inverted vessel. Okay. We are trying to pour the water, but the, you know, vessel is not in the receptive mode. And this whole training, leadership development to anything will become so much powerful if we just, you know, turn the vessel, if we just enhance the attention skills, more presence, more focus, more attention. And magic can happen both in terms of learnability, grasping, and its application. Okay. So this is the second shift that we are witnessing in terms of learning. So we spoke about engagement, and then we spoke about how it is shifting to reverse engagement, the care and empathy. The focus is now shifting to manager. Now from behavioral skills, now the focus is shifting more internal, more to neurology, more to psychology, where my mind pays attention to and how do I manage and train my attention. Okay. And let's go to the third aspect, which is well-being. And again, as you would predict, the questions are going to be the same. And if you would share a few strategies that we use for well-being and we ourselves use, or possibly as you've seen happening world over, any top major strategies or general popular strategies? Work-life balance, great. So Sanjay is saying that we work towards work-life balance. We help them achieve work-life balance, so they achieve well-being. Health policies, absolutely. Okay. And here we are talking about well-being in two terms, physical well-being and mental well-being. These are the two aspects that we are talking about. Employee welfare initiatives, recreational activities, so that there is more positive emotions that come. Yes, that's what Sudha is mentioning. Srinivas is mentioning about employee welfare. Absolutely, absolutely. Okay, Sanjay is mentioning that, you know, post-COVID well-being has become a major priority. Absolutely, absolutely. Right now, everybody is talking about the mental health and helping people overcome their stress and anxiety, helping them engaged. Absolutely. Absolutely. And again, as you would have predicted, I will ask you about the success. How much you think, and again, please share that percentage response. How much are we successful in our efforts in helping people with their well-being, overall well-being? We are talking about overall well-being. Indraneel has mentioned increased personal touch in conversation. That's great. Okay. And we are getting responses from 40% to 80%. Okay, very nice. I mean, that's a great number. 50%, 70%, 50, 60%. So again, Snigdha is mentioning that, see, it is very employee specific. How much benefit do they get? It depends a lot on them as well. Absolutely. You're very true. Okay, perfect. And Sanjay is mentioning that while earlier it was lower, but post-COVID, because of the extra emphasis, and even employees are becoming more sincere about it, so the impact would be higher. Absolutely, absolutely. No, I think last so many years, there has been a lot of good focus on mental well-being, good awareness. People are talking about it. There are so many initiatives, employee assistance programs, and counseling, and workplace activities, open communication, open talk about it is happening. So there is very good work that is happening on it. And I'm sure we have achieved a good distance. But let me again put a but on this and share that the statistics are still a bit gloomy. The workplace stress is still sad. And I think you would have read about a couple of stories where two very senior executives collapsed during the work meetings. While these are sporadic, you know, one-off cases, but it also shows these are the cases we come to know because there is something very extreme that has happened. But we don't come to know about so many people who are living in huge stress, anxiety, and you know, feeling a lot of some people even getting into depression. We don't get to know a lot about them. Okay. While we have achieved and we are working well and we have made available a lot of things to people, but still in terms of the final outcome, we still need to go a long way. We still need to go a long way. Mental well-being is still a part where we need to do more. When we need to do more, it does not mean we need to do more of what we are already doing, but possibly again here also, we might want to look at a strategic shift. Okay. And as Indraneel is saying that, you know, there is a lot of judgment that happens, and we need to start from being open-mindedness. And the good thing is we have actually made a big difference here. While possibly a decade back, you know, we would not even talk about it, but today people are coming out openly talking about depression and stress and mental health. So I, you know, definitely we have achieved a good success in this, but are we just going to sit on that success, or are we going to, refine our course of action and achieve some larger success? And this is what now we are going to talk about. Now, well-being, we have been speaking more in terms of the external aspects. So, you know, work-life balance and recreational activities, and you know, there is so much which is external stress. How do we get good sleep? How do we use work from home for better well-being? But there is a very little emphasis that is being given to the neurological well-being, the game which is happening inside. So while we are trying to do everything on what's happening outside, but see, stress plays here inside. So what is the game which is happening inside? On that, there is a very little emphasis. There is very little work that is happening. So let's again get into a little experiential mode and understand this part as well, so we know and we understand this strategic shift as well in a more appropriate manner. Okay, so let's do a thought experiment, very quick thought experiment. Again, I'm taking you a bit in a little different direction, more going inside like we did last time with distraction and wandering. So get ready with that particular that type of thought process. Now, just imagine that you are getting angry. Okay, let's do one thing. Easier thing is pretend to be angry. So your screens are off. Hopefully nobody is watching you. Just pretend to be angry, very, very angry right now. Okay, and as you are doing that, and as you are get into that anger mode completely, and as you are getting into that, just reflect, what is your body doing? What's happening? How your body is reacting as you're getting angry? And if you can write few things, that will be helpful. So can you just mention a couple of things? Heartbeat racing, very nice. Feeling very stiff. Oh, absolutely. The body, whole body becomes stiff. Okay. And you know why body becomes stiff? The limbs, the hands and legs are getting ready to fight or flight. That's the reason it is getting stiff. Okay. Frowning, you know, the face, holding the breath. Rather, some of the people are holding the breath, freezing, or actually the heart, you know, the breathing has increased. You might also realize, which you are not mentioned here, but possibly not even noticed, that your fist will clench. Isn't it? And your teeth grit. Isn't it? Oh, absolutely. And even you're talking about how it is impacting internally. Yeah. Want to be violent. Elizabeth is mentioning very rightly. Actually, it is the violent behavior that is coming out, because this is, there is nobody in front of you. Okay. And even when we get angry, when there is someone in front of you, do we really need to, you know, use our claws or use our jaws? I mean, this was needed when we were living in the jungles and lion is coming in front of us and we have to fight or flight. But that is the response we still give. Today, that response is not at all needed, but we still give. And the reason is, as psychologists say, we are still an old mind in a new body. See, when we are talking about well-being, we need to understand the neurology, the psychology, what's the game which is happening inside. Otherwise, we can't take care of it. Everything will be superficial, external. Okay. Our old mind, and you know what I'm talking about, we are talking about amygdala. As you know, amygdala is this part of the brain, which is indicated here with the yellow outline. It is our panic button. It is our panicky watchman. As soon as it experiences any threat or danger, it starts giving emotional overreactions. Okay, so there are four things that amygdala does when we perceive any threat. First of all, it's in autopilot mode, which means it works in advance than thinking. So thinking will come later. Obviously, I mean, if we have to survive, we can't be thinking. Lion is in front of us and we can't be thinking whether it's a man-eater or not, whether it is lunchtime or not. We just need to fight or flight. Okay, so it's autopilot. Amygdala fills us completely with negativity. Why? Because negative information is required for survival, and positivity goes back. So when amygdala is active, we are all filled with negative aspects, and positivity goes back. When amygdala is active, we only think of the current problem, and we forget everything about you know, there are so many aspects of life. There are so many future things, because amygdala says, bother about the current problem, not about later. Okay. So narrow thinking, short-term thinking, negative thinking, and emotional overreaction are the characteristics of amygdala. Okay. Now, what you see around, whether it is irritation, whether it is people becoming very, very fragile and emotional on Twitter or Facebook, or people becoming violent, or people having mood swing, or even going to extremes, people committing crimes against others, against themselves. This is all amygdala getting overheated, getting hyper, getting out of control. Now, we can do so many things outside, but when amygdala gets overheated, lot of things will happen at different levels. So from small mood swing to a very violent behavior, I could be reacting in the whole game is happening inside. Now, the point is, we continue to work on external behaviors, external well-being. And that is important. Again, I'm not saying, you know, we should not. We should. That's non-negotiable. That's absolutely required. But the point is, we are still missing out a large factor, a big factor. Okay. And we need to work towards it. And this is the third strategic shift which we are witnessing, where we, so again, about the past experience, you know, the well-being 3 decades back was all about physical activity, physical exercise, body. My body should be healthy. My physical health should be up. Okay. And then we realized, no, that's not the case. I think we need our mental well-being as well, mental health as well. And for that, there are a lot of feel-good aspects, from recreation to work from home. There are some things which actually help us feel good about ourselves, which help us feel better. You know, they give us a bit of positive emotions inside our mind. There are a lot of activities which begin to happen to make sure. But then we are also realizing that these feel good exercises are good, they are helpful, but still we need a larger shift towards neuroplasticity. And when we say neuroplasticity, it simply means we need to work on the internal game, the neurological game of stress, anxiety, depression, worries, anger, phobias. There is a lot which is happening inside. If we work on that, many other outer aspects are getting cared for. So this is the third strategic shift that we are talking about in terms of well-being. So well-being from physical exercise to mental feel-good exercises to now some neuroplasticity related interventions or enablers are something which are the next aspects which are coming in. So we just, covered the three aspects. You remember employee engagement, capability, and well-being. And we now know that where the shift is happening. I'm not saying that these things have become mainstream as of now. No, they have not become mainstream. And that's where we are talking about them as future trends. But as people are realizing about how our, you know, engagement is still not high, our leadership development program still not giving so much results, behavioral skill programs are still giving less than 10%, 15% results, our well-being, people are still so much stressed out, people are still so much anxious, work-life balance and so many things are still out of sync. So it is giving rise to the shift where we are realizing that engagement is all about focusing on the manager and focusing on empathy. In well-being, we are talking about the neuroplasticity and capability. We are talking about training the attention and managing the focus. Okay. Now, as we come to this part, see, some of you have raised hands, and just to keep the flow on, we are not taking any questions immediately, but let the session get over and please keep your questions with you. Don't write them on the chat window right now, because they will get drowned into the chats. Rather keep it for the end. And we will discuss on that. And as Sonal mentioned, that how do we solve this? And that's where we are coming to. See, we don't have a clear solution. What we just discussed in last, you know, some time is our focus has been on a particular aspect, but now let's shift the attention, shift our focus on some more core aspects. Now, when we focus on those core aspects, how do we achieve results is something we need to discuss. And that's where we are talking about mindfulness. Now, let me tell you, say at this point itself, mindfulness may not be the complete answer for everything. But in light of these priorities, let's see where mindfulness can fit in, how much it can help, and is there any way in which we as HR professionals can leverage it for us, for ourselves, for our people, and for our organizations. Okay. So there wouldn't be a better way to understand mindfulness than actually to get a glimpse of it, actually to have a bit of experience. Yeah. So why not we do a quick exercise for around 2 to 3 minutes. Are you all ready for that? As I said, your yes matters so much. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. You know, as soon as you write yes, there is so much feeling of connectivity that comes. Thank you. You are very empathetic and caring. Okay. So, okay. Now, I request each one of you to just close your eyes. And as you close your eyes, become aware of your posture. And first focus on your lower body. How is the posture of your feet, legs, and thighs? Are they very comfortably placed on whatever surface they are being placed on? Your feet might be on the floor in your footwear. Your thighs on the chair or any other surface. You can move it and make it more comfortable. Now focus on your upper body and see if upper body, including hands, is very comfortably placed. Check on your neck and check on your back. Is your neck and back straight? At this point, notice that your body is breathing. And it's breathing automatically. You may even notice the touch of air in the nostrils. You may even notice that your stomach moves as you breathe. All this is happening automatically. Now, let's shift our focus to our feet and notice the touch of your feet on the surface, surface of your footwear, surface of the floor, or anywhere else where the skin of feet is touching to the surface. Become aware of the exact quality of the touch between your feet and the surface. Are your feet sweating? Are your feet warm or cold? Just become aware. Now, shift your focus to your thighs. And notice how your thighs are touching the place where you are sitting. Now, shifting up, let's go to our back and notice the touch of clothes on your back. At this point, observe your facial muscles and what do you feel inside your facial muscles? And now let's take our attention to the sounds around. Become aware of the sounds which are just entering into your ears right now. So focus on your ears and notice the pure sounds, any type of sound which you are observing right now. Could be subtle sounds, heavy sounds. Now, let's bring our attention back to our body. Become aware of the weight of your body, how it is pressing on the place where you are sitting. Let's bring our attention back to our breathing, the natural flow of breathing. Now, take a deep breath in and slowly out. Take one more deep breath in and slowly out. And very slowly, as you feel comfortable, open your eyes. And as you open your eyes, just come back into the session. And as you come back into the session, reflect on how did you feel. And you may even write it in the chat box. How did you feel? The first quick word or phrase that comes to your mind, you can just write it. Great, nice, relaxed, peaceful, relaxed, focus, relaxed. Nice, relaxed, focused, peaceful as the theme that we are continuously getting. Transition, soothing. Nice. Sachin is mentioning soothing. Nice. Aware what is happening. There's a lot of great, even enhanced awareness that you are experiencing. Wonderful. Superb. Thank you so much for reflecting on this. Now, mindfulness, as we just practiced, is nothing but a state of mind. It's a very specialized state of mind. While mindfulness is termed as a practice as well, as a technique as well, but it's also a state. When we say be mindful, mindfulness is not just being aware. Generally, it's very trivialized. Mindfulness is a specialized state. It's a one of the states, as we have the sleeping, wakeful, unconscious, subconscious. Mindfulness is also a state. And as we bring our attention to the present task, present experience, and we keep it there in a very purposeful, very specified manner, then gradually our mind gets into a different zone. Different neural patterns actually get activated. Some patterns get deactivated during that time. So there is a lot of neural game which is happening inside, because mostly we feel mindfulness is just a feel good exercise. I mean, I close my eyes and I felt good, but not like that. Let me give you an evidence for that, that it's not just a simple feel good. Now, you remember you did that 2 minute eye closing exercise as well, where you were observing your mind. Compare that exercise with this. You are saying you are feeling relaxed. Everybody is saying relaxed, peaceful, soothing and all. But think about it. I made you do so much hard work. Go to the sound, go to the bag, go to the feet, go here, go to the breathing. Your mind was continuously in action. But in the first exercise, eye closing, you were just relaxed, doing nothing. Now, ideally speaking, your mind should have been more relaxed, more peaceful in that exercise rather than this. But that's opposite. And that should make us think why that is happening. You know why that is happening? It's because there are specific areas of mind, of brain, which have got activated and which have got deactivated. For example, the yellow portion that you see, yellow golden part that you see, is called prefrontal cortex. I think most of you are aware of that. This big prefrontal cortex is only there in human beings. This is responsible for awareness, leadership, creativity, and all. There's another area called hippocampus. There are different areas which get activated when we are doing this mindfulness exercise. There are areas like amygdala, which actually get a bit deactivated. I'm not saying they are like completely shut down, but their activity level goes down. Okay. And that's the reason we start feeling relaxed and peaceful. Now, when we use the word peaceful or relaxed, it's a simple word, but there is a lot which has already gone inside our brain, which has led to that experience. Okay. And this is a great news, because focus, awareness, relaxation, calm, stability, these are the capabilities which we need a lot. And we just saw a glimpse that we can actually do a lot of things around it. Now, in next few minutes, we are going to understand a bit of neurology and bit of application in the context of HR strategy. So we have gone quite inside, and now we are gradually coming out how these things relate to the discussion that we have today in terms of our HR strategy and what we can do about it. Okay. So let's quickly look at a few neurological aspects. Okay. Now, and I'm just showing it to you, the four major aspects. Now, these are not the only things. These are just four areas which we have mentioned. Okay. But so, for example, hippocampus, which is directly connected with memory and learning, gets impacted. And we can see the clear connectivity with our capability, the learning part. Amygdala is directly correlated with our well-being. We just did our thought experiment and we realized on that. And temporoparietal junction, which is the connecting point between the temporal lobe and the parietal lobe, is responsible for enhancing the empathetic and compassionate feelings. Okay. Now, let's understand this very clearly. Many times we say, okay, I got to be empathetic. I got to be empathetic. Now, telling ourselves, I got to be empathetic, I got to be positive, it's a fallacy. I can't tell myself and become empathetic. Okay. I can't tell myself, become fit, and I'll become fit. Okay. I need to go out, jog, do my planks, do my push-ups and all that. And then as a consequence, I become fit. Now, if I want to become empathetic, I just can't tell myself, rather I do something and then there are neurological changes happen and I become empathetic. Now that's the wonderful part. And that's where we are talking about the neurology and neuroplasticity. And that's where the whole shift is happening, where rather than telling, we are talking about creating the enablers, which actually create the difference inside, which becomes visible outside. So it's an inside out, enabler that we are talking about. Now, everything that we have spoken about has come out from a lot of reputed universities research. MIT was the first one in late 1980s, 70s. They started researching on effect of mindfulness on stress. And this study by Jon Kabat-Zinn became so famous that many other universities came together. They not only researched, they even created departments and centers on mindfulness. And now there are thousands of studies which are published on multiple domains, from productivity, leadership, creativity, well-being, anything. And we have very specific solutions and studies and evidences that mindfulness is working on very specific aspects. And let's have a look at a few very quickly. I'm just going to give you a glimpse. Maybe later on I can share this, some of the slides and all with you, so you have this for reference. But giving you a reference, we are not going to go deep into each of the things, but there are multiple studies which show how much we can enhance empathy and leadership. We can reduce conflicts. We can create greater relationship between a manager and an employee, between leader and the organizational employees. And we can create a much greater difference in terms of engagement. So you remember we were talking about engagement and reverse engagement. Now, rather than, putting all our resources into making employee engaged, can we divert a few resources, time and effort, and we say, okay, now can I do something to make my leaders more empathetic? Can I make my managers more empathetic? We focus a little bit more, give more extra emphasis on that, and then we start having the ripple effects. So mindfulness has shown clear evidenced impact and outcomes in terms of leadership and empathy. You should read just Google HBR leadership mindfulness. You would find so amazing content on how mindfulness is transforming leadership. Okay. Now, again, these are a couple of statements. Now, let me just come to the performance enhancement. Okay. Again, there are multiple studies. We are speaking about productivity, focus, attention. When we bring our attention into the present experience, when we train our attention in a way that it stays, it becomes deep, it becomes more focused, actually a lot of magic happens in terms of productivity, depth, creativity, ruminations go away. We have cognitive flexibility. And this is so important for everybody. I mean, from employees to leaders, because we become so rigid when our wandering mind and thought hopping mind, continuous distraction is happening. The cognitive rigidity that becomes very, very high. Okay. Again, in terms of the resilience and well-being, there are numerous studies which show tremendous benefit. And mindfulness started with stress. So well-being is the first core area which it addresses. But afterwards, mindfulness has been proven to work on all the three areas: performance, resilience, and relationships. So now, there is a lot of work which has happened in terms of the mental well-being and the emotional well-being. Daniel Goleman, again, he is a big proponent of mindfulness, and he and Dr. Richard Davidson have written a book called Altered Traits. And there they mention how we can even change our long-term personalities towards positivity by using the techniques of mindfulness. So when we are talking about even on the larger aspect, so we spoke about the three aspects, but even the larger aspect, if you look at it, turnover and attrition, okay, there is a clear correlation between turnover. So turnover intention, we are talking about how many such people are, thinking of leaving the job, has got an inverse correlation from mindfulness. And there are these different studies that happened in call centers and Dow Chemicals and those, and they started to show multifaceted benefits coming out when mindfulness is rightly implemented. Okay. Again, I'm emphasizing the word rightly implemented. Now, one area that we didn't discuss about, and I just want to touch, is talent acquisition, where even we need to work more. We are not still very much equipped with how can we use it greatly in talent acquisition, but more in terms of the unbiased behaviors. Reducing the bias, both in terms of selections and also in terms of enhancing the diversity inside the organization. Mindfulness works greatly, and indirectly it works by enhancing the employee engagement or overall candidate engagement, as the recruiters pay complete attention to the subtle cues and what their needs are. Okay. Now, as we just spoke about, I mean, we just quickly ran through some of these studies, but as we realized that all the three areas that we spoke about, whether we spoke about empathy, reverse engagement, we spoke about capability, attention management, or we spoke about well-being in terms of neurological aspect, mindfulness has its own contribution and mindfulness has its own benefits, proven benefits. Again, please remember, we are not saying that mindfulness is is the panacea for everything or mindfulness can solve everything. Not at all. I mean, anybody who is saying that, it's a hype, but mindfulness can help in a lot of powerful ways. It can bring a lot of fundamental differences. And that's the reason that starting with Google, many organizations adopted mindfulness. So Google case study is very, very famous. You should look it out on Google itself and find out what happened. But they adopted mindfulness in such deep manner. They have their own internal program called GPause, and thousands of employees get trained into it. And there are so many organizations world over. You see any Fortune 500 company and they have adopted mindfulness in one way or the other. And very deeply, it's not just, you know, one training program or something. So SAP has got a chief mindfulness officer. Can you believe that? So amazing. Intel has got their own program. Aetna did so deep studies. They found that mindfulness and techniques, mindfulness interventions are enhancing their productivity by $3,000 per year per employee. You know, that's the number they came out. Then there are many Indian organizations where even we have been supporting the deeper implementation. But world over, and large organizations, large conglomerates have adopted this because I think the trend that we are seeing, as you see, the big trend that is coming largely, the whole focus is shifting and organizations are using it on multiple areas, you know, from as simple as customer focus to enhancing the agility to well-being to leadership development. And when we speak about the focus areas, okay, let me just go back and look at and show you the, okay, sorry for that. I think I just wanted to show you the graph, the graph where we spoke about the three areas, engagement to reverse engagement, well-being to neurological, neuroplasticity oriented intervention, and in terms of the productivity, capability part, where we are talking about giving more focus on attention and skills. Now, any ripple effect, any shootouts of any of these aspects, you can see organizations world over are adopting it. Let me also just show you a bit of journey that organizations have taken in terms of mindfulness. Because if we say, and today, as we have discussed about the strategic shift that's been taking place over the years, and as we'll see in the coming years, and what it means for us as in terms of, you know, organizational HR leaders, and how it can impact our people. Now, let's also see what's happening globally and how globally organizations are adopting mindfulness in different ways. So most of the organizations are making a beginning by creating the awareness, orientation, few activities. I remember, I think it was Maersk, which shared that they introduced a very simple activity called mindful hand wash. Okay, so just 1 minute activity, guided activity, and person washes hands very, very mindfully. So starting creating awareness at this very basic level, and we all can do this in our organizations, doing this very basic small orientation activities. The next immediate activity definitely is to help leadership to get exposed to mindfulness, because when leadership is exposed, they can percolate it down to the levels downward. Sometimes, you know, most of times opposite doesn't happen. The organizations which go further, they also start identifying very specific challenges, for example, stress, for example, performance aspects, for example, relationship issues or leadership or culture. And they start using very specific interventions to resolve those specific challenges. And then there are organizations which go for deeper adoption at a very wider level. So, you know, not focused on just particular some groups, but rather going possibly across the organization or to the larger levels. And then a good success comes when we have started adopting mindfulness at the cultural level. How do we actually on a day-to-day behaviors, then we start looking at how mindful we are and how mindful we are as an organization. And the ultimate part, ultimate level, which Google or Intel or SAP has achieved, is when organizations have their own internal programs which are driven by internal champions. We are so fortunate that we have seen a complete cycle of these aspects. I mean, this is not something which is new and which is happening and which we need to experiment with. Rather, there are so many case studies which are available, ready-made, last 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, experience of the organizations are available with us. And so if we have to chart out our path, we can do it in a much more effective manner. Okay. Now, just concluding on the overall strategic shift that we have been speaking about. So from infrastructure to the inner mind structure, gradually we are moving, whether it is care, whether it is well-being, or whether it is productivity, because it is human, because it is person, it all boils down to this particular part of the body where we need to create the impact. Again, rather than telling people what to do or, you know, pushing people or motivating people, now the focus is coming more in terms of the mutation, and mutation simply means alteration. So we are not talking about telling people, okay, become empathetic, become focused, become this, become this. Rather, we are enabling an internal mutation, okay, in the neurological sense. And third change is enforcing. From enforcing to we are getting into empathetic aspect. So managers, rather than forcing, enforcing, coercing people to get their work done, now we give care, we give empathy, and people are self-motivated, self-driven to actually go extra mile for their managers and for their people. And this is so great because we keep talking about human resource. And, you know, I think so many years we've been talking about, no, we need to move from resource to human. You know, we should become more human. HR should become more human. Organization should become more human. And if you look at these aspects, the aspects on left and right, you would see that we are actually moving towards more human aspects. It's such a great news. We are actually, the trend is showing that we are actually moving. It's up to us how much speed we give to it. I mean, you know, at our own level, at collective level, how much pace that we give, that these changes start to be visible in a mainstream level. Now, as an HR leader, HR professional, now there are few suggestions, few shift that you would also want to make. Again, in terms of knowledge, you would want to go through a lot of work. I think you're already doing that, but I still emphasize not only positive psychology, but the neurological aspects. I think we as HR fraternity, we should gain a good understanding in these areas. Now the Courseras and Udemy's of the world are so much available that we have got very good knowledge available here. We must now as HR managers focus on making every line manager HR manager. We have been keep talking that HR is not the role of HR manager, it's the role of line manager. Now we know at least what to help them with, what to enable with them, and that's empathy. That's empathetic behavior. Now, empathetic behavior is not something which will come very easily. It has its own dimensions, it has its own complexities, but we at least know something with which we can start with, which we can help our managers. Even there have been studies on narcissist, you know, behaviors, and there have been a good substantial change in their own behaviors when the mindfulness interventions are applied on them. Okay, I strongly suggest that you get very good exposure on executing these neuroplasticity based interventions, not just mindfulness, but anything which has direct impact, as we said, motivation to mutation. So, you know, rather than just getting onto the motivation side, which has its own limited applicability, let's get into the enabling mutation part and see the longer term cycle of how we begin with those interventions and how do we gain and measure those outcomes. That would be one of the most valuable experience and exposure that you as HR professionals could possibly get. Again, I mean, no brainer on certifications and courses. Even we would be coming out with a lot of courses and certifications in the coming days. So, and that might be useful for you. Again, individually as HR professionals, I strongly recommend that you start adopting mindfulness in your own life and develop these three capabilities of paying mindful attention, mindful listening, and mindful relaxation. So more you adopt mindfulness in your own life, the all other parts where you need to really adopt and apply, that would become much more easy. Okay, now we are actually running out of time because we have already crossed the time limits. I wanted to share a few exercises with you in terms of mindfulness, which can be adopted. I'm right now just skipping that for the time being, so that we cover the last part as well. And if anybody who has to leave for, you know, as the schedule is already over, so we can possibly take that up later point of time. But only thing that I'm telling you right now is you yourself practice, persist, do a lot of dialogues and discussion around these aspects. Like we have come together today on this Zoom call, come together with your team members and practice together. No better way than to teach and take orientation of your own people in mindfulness. Okay. And finally, if you are the change, if you create the change for yourself by using mindfulness, other people will witness the benefit. This is how mindfulness started in Google. One person started bringing change in himself, and then he introduced mindfulness in Google, and then it spread like anything. Okay. So this is where we come to the end of this session. And I would definitely, as I think Suprabha is saying, that we would want to know a few more action points which we can apply in the organization. And we are going to discuss definitely, but just in the interest of time and interest of everybody, let me first ask if there are any specific questions before I share with you the one, two, or three techniques, whatever the time is available with us for using the organization. Any questions that you might have at this point of time? Okay, so then let me go back. Okay, some good readings. Somebody's asking, I would suggest Mindfulness for Beginners by John Kabat-Zinn is a good book. Even a different book, which does not talk about mindfulness, but it's very much mindfulness, is a very popular book called Power of Now by Eckhart Tolle. It's a great practical mindfulness book. Okay. Before I get into the action, I think Ritesh is mentioning he would like to share something. Ritesh, would you like to share something now, and then I get into the techniques part? Do you suggest that?
Yeah.
Okay. Sure.
So thank you so much, Sapan, for giving such a wonderful and insightful session. And is the kind of title of this today's webinar is winning HR game with mindfulness. And it quite resonating, seeing overall a session and kind of all the HR functionalities that you have covered up here. It was really amazing and quite interactive. And I hope everyone has enjoyed this thing, and people have seen the various kind of techniques or maybe an importance of the mindfulness for the HR fraternity, as well as within the organizations, how people management and talent management can be developed through mindfulness. So that was amazing things. Now I would like to share a good announce a kind of an masterclass that we are planning for. So 6 weeks back we had a launch a new masterclass program which was Decoding Mindfulness at Workplace, and it was a very comprehensive program for the HR professionals who had want to become a kind of an internal mindfulness strategies within the organization. So this program was very well received and had greater demands, and we are launching the second edition of the such programs it's a 3 days program in month of October. So I would like to share my screen and wanted to share you a few of the details, so accordingly you can see how it's gonna be important for all of you. Just a minute. Is my screen visible, Sapan?
Not yet. I think it is coming, but Yeah, it's there.
Yeah, so this is the mindfulness, decoding mindfulness at workplace second editions that we are announcing for 16th, 17th and 23rd of October. That is Friday, Saturday and Friday, and which is a 3 days masterclass, which would be, you know, with 2 weeks of support over the WhatsApp, which full of a lot of activities and practical sessions on that. And, you know, for this registrations and more details, I am also pasting the link on this chat window, so you can get more details about this thing. If you have any questions, any doubts, you can always, you know, be in touch with you know, numbers mentioned over here, as well as get in touch with me. Is my number is already there here. So yeah, that's it. So I would like to announce this program, and let's take the benefit whoever is interested for this. Yes, Apan, over to you. If you can give more insights about the same program and master mindfulness.
Yes, yes. I will just now come back. Thanks so much, Ritesh, for sharing this. I mean, so, you know, this session, this program, Decoding Mindfulness at Workplace, is for people who would want to go extra level, extra expertise level, next expertise level in mindfulness. They would want to become the internal mindfulness strategist for their own organizations. They would want to gain how exactly and what tools, what specific ways in which we can begin, in which we can sustain, and we can actually do evidence-based, ROI-based, outcome-based support in the organization. So the whole idea is you become the internal mindfulness strategist and drive mindfulness in your organization for the larger benefit. So it gives quite deep dive aspects in terms of global case studies, you know, specific toolkits. It also has a 1 week support system in terms of your step-by-step practical application. And definitely it is going to help in your own mindfulness journey as well. Yeah. So do join. I mean, if you think that that is the journey that you would like to take. Now, again, I'm taking a bit of extra time from you all, but just so that we also cover the tools, let me share these 4 tools with you, which you can start using for yourself as well as for your organization. And first thing, and very simple thing, is called mindful meeting. Okay. Now 60 seconds, it's a 60 second exercise, very similar to what we did in the beginning. You remember when we began the session, we became aware of the surroundings, the colors and shapes and all. Now, this is the same thing. Now, at an individual level, before we get into any meeting, so what happens is most of the time, any of us are getting in the meeting in a very rushed up manner, and amygdala is very, very highly activated. Our listening will be low, our reactions would be high, and our connectivity with people will be very, very low. Now, we need to stabilize amygdala and activate prefrontal cortex, and this 60 second exercise can be powerful. Very simple. Divide 60 seconds into 3 parts, 20, 20, 20. First 20 seconds, become aware of the surroundings, same colors and shapes. Next 20 seconds, become aware of your posture. Get into your body. And next 20 seconds, become aware of your breathing. Very simple. 20 second surroundings, 20 second posture, 20 second breathing. Now, I suggest, and you know, I mean, you can create this larger change. Why don't you do it in the meetings which are going to happen and involve everyone? 60 seconds is not a huge time, but rather than people just getting bombarded into the session, into the meeting, and you know, and talking in a very distracted and in a wandering manner, these 60 seconds will bring everybody together in such an effective manner. Okay, I'm not saying that this will change everything, but this is a great beginning. 60 seconds, everybody can spare. So suggestion is, do it yourself, definitely, but even do it sometimes in meetings, in your own teams or with other teams. Introduce this technique, this support for other team members, other people as well in the organization. Google, many of their conference rooms have got these mindfulness exercises built in their conference screens. When they go, they begin the mindfulness exercise, people sit, stabilize, and then they begin the meeting. You will see drastic difference in the quality of conversations. So that's the first tool I strongly suggest to begin with. The second tool is a very, very powerful tool in today's life. And Interoception simply means becoming aware of your body sensations. Okay. So whenever we are stressed out, okay, this is the best technique to dilute our stress levels. Stress is nothing but amygdalic unconscious activity. Now, when we bring a lot of awareness to the sensation of stress, okay, the amygdalic activity dilutes and prefrontal cortex becomes strong. You have seen the effect of these things happening when you did the mindfulness exercise today. So the way to do it is three steps. P-I-L. P means pause. Okay. Pause means, so if you're feeling stressed out, anger, fear, whatever you're feeling, any uncomfortable emotion, even simple mood swing, bad mood. Okay. Just pause. Don't do anything. Don't take any action. Don't say anything. P, then I, go inside. Go inside your body rather than being outside, go inside. And L, locate sensations. Which is the heaviest sensation? If you are afraid, a sensation would be in stomach. If you are angry, it would be in face or in hands. If you are stressed out, it would be in the head. So just notice the where the heaviest sensations are and just stay with it. Just stay with it. And believe me, even if you are there with those sensations mindfully for few minutes, 2-3 minutes, 4 minutes, the whole amygdalic reaction will come down. Now, I strongly suggest doing this exercise, 5 minute exercise once in a week in the group in your organization. Okay. And what you can do is get everybody together for a 5 minute exercise where they will focus on whatever is the heaviest sensation. They need not feel anger or stress or anything, but you know, we all the time have some heaviness in some part. Okay. So they can focus on that particular a sensation and just stay with it for 5 minutes. It's a great exercise in building overall resilience. Okay. We have a lot of audios which have, we have developed internally. And if you would need that, please do write to us and we will definitely share those audios as well with you. Okay. So P I L, pause, go inside and locate sensations. Okay. Tool number three is to achieve your great potential. And potential amongst the employees. It is the antidote for distracted working. Okay. And deep work simply means I am picking a task, picking a time, and picking a place where I'll do undistracted work. No phone call, no messages, no disturbance, no other thoughts. I'm just focusing on one particular aspect. Now, very important that you fix a time. So you say every day, 11 to 12, every day, you know, 9 to 10, I will do my deep work. But very important, the next aspect, task. What task? The task has to be a good, intellectual, interesting task. It should not be, you know, filling your bills or checking your emails or anything. Okay. It has to be an intellectually stimulating task. Okay. So it could be as simple as reading a book, but intellectually stimulating task. You use it for deep work. So decide the task and decide the place where you will not be disturbed. Okay. Deep work itself is a big topic. We take 2-day program on deep work, but you can start doing deep work by just following TTP, time, task, and place. And just begin this. I mean, there is nothing, if you can read the work, deep work, book deep work, that would be very, very helpful to you. 30 minute once in a week, you can start with. That would be a great beginning. At an organizational level, many places when we have done programs, they have started creating specific deep work time for the whole organization or for the team. So for example, one organization I remember, there is a bell rings at 11 a.m. So 11 to 12 is the deep work time where people will not be disturbed. People will be just focused on, you know, their own intellectual task. No messaging, no emails, nothing. It's a great way. So you can start it in your own team, in your own organization. It's a very simple way. Okay. I mean, you just need to get the consensus, get the time, and start using deep work techniques. So any more clarity that you would need on deep work, because deep work is a little deeper topic. Okay. Do let us know. We will be happy to support you on that. And the fourth and the most important tool is Mindful Gym. And Mindful Gym is nothing but, I mean, very similar exercise as we did when we did mindfulness. So what we did was we were sitting and there were some instructions coming And those instructions were telling us to go into some present experience, you know, becoming aware of the present experience, present happening, present sensation inside our body or outside or anywhere. Now, this is the same way we do mindful gym. So pick any audio and just have it 10, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, whatever duration that you want to have. Just follow the instruction and come into the present experience. This is as simple as that. I mean, things can't be, you know, so powerful and so simple at the same time that we are sitting and doing nothing but getting some life-changing benefits. Okay. Now, this is attention muscles gym. And why we call it gym? Because like we flex our muscles in the gym, okay, we are doing the same thing here. So what would happen? As you focus on the audio, your attention will go away. As your attention go away, you will bring it back. Away, bring it back, bring it back, bring it back. Now, what's happening is you are strengthening, you are lifting the weight, you are strengthening the muscles of bringing back attention. You are creating a new habit, neuroplasticity. You are creating a new habit of bringing the attention back into the present. And as you do it in these 15 minutes, you will feel the ripple effects even during the day where your attention is actually coming back. Okay, so use these exercises. So we spoke about the four areas. Okay, now this particular mindful gym, I suggest again, you do it as a group as well. We have seen many organizations have adopted it as a group exercise. One CEO actually started doing it with their monthly review meeting. So monthly review meeting will start with a 10 minute mindfulness exercise. Everybody will do the mindfulness exercise and then they will get into the meeting. We have seen groups which are coming together. I mean, it is pre-COVID time I'm talking about, after lunch. So immediately after lunch, rather than going for a walk or something, they came together and did the 10 minute mindfulness activity together. It's a great bonding activity. It's really, really amazing. You know, people, I mean, you know, these techniques look simple, but these are beginning. I mean, there are hundreds of techniques. But these are some of the most powerful techniques if we start using these sincerely. And please make a 21-day commitment to yourself and say, I will use it in this particular way. Every day mindful gym, once in a week deep work, once in a week introspection, twice a week or thrice a week of mindful pause, mindful meetings. You create a schedule for yourself. You don't need any trainer. You don't need any external intervention. You can actually start using it yourself and start creating the difference for yourself. Yeah. See, mindfulness is such a powerful thing. I mean, we feel it's a gift and we have realized tremendous, tremendous benefits for ourselves. I mean, we feel that this world, this life can be so amazing. I mean, so cohesive, so wonderful, so empathetic, so powerful if we actually are, you know, if more and more people become mindful in this world. So we are here for this mission and we are so privileged. We are so, you know, feeling great to have you as partner in these efforts because we know that you as HR leaders, HR professionals are going to take these efforts forward and make a difference in the life of so many people in your organizations. So wishing the best, wishing you all mindfulness for yourself, wishing that we all make a great transition into the new strategies, new trends, which helps each one of us and to this world. Yeah. Let me thank Digital HR. Let me thank Ritesh for, you know, setting up this program so well. And special thanks to each one of you because this whole, online sessions have so much limited connectivity. We don't have face-to-face and, you know, close proximity, but by your interaction, by your reflections, by your sharings, by your questions, you made it so interactive, so exciting for me as well. So special thanks to you. I really hope to meet you all in person very soon as the situations become appropriate. So till then, thank you so much. You have a good evening and you stay safe, stay healthy.